friends. I'm so glad you're here today. I'm really excited for our small group. We are going to begin today in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're going to light our candle, which helps remind us that wherever we are gathered, Jesus is here. This is our sacred space together today. I want us all to start with a prayer. Gracious God, thank you so much for bringing us together today to share our stories. Help us to open our minds, open our ears and eyes as we listen for God in the stories all around us. Amen. Sage, can you share with us a blessing and brews that you have today?
Sure. A blessing is that on Monday, I'm going to go spend a day with my grandma. We're gonna go shopping. I'm really excited to spend time with her because I know sometimes she gets lonely. I just want her to know that I love her. We really enjoy going shopping and baking cookies together, especially around Christmas time. I really enjoy it. And a bruise is that my other grandma, who lives in Illinois, lives alone with just her husband, and she tells me all the time that she's really lonely and that she wants to hug me, and that makes me really sad because I want to be there for her and I really wish we could visit, but I don't want to get like anyone sick or anything, you know.
Let's get together and feel alright.
Oh, Pastor Aaron, how are you?
Hey, Pastor Dave.
Yeah, I don't know if I told you, but I got a little nervous this week visiting the doctor's office.
Oh!
There was a new nurse. He said he was a recent graduate of nursing school, and after taking my blood pressure, he pulled out a piece of paper and a red pen, and he began to draw. And when I asked what he was doing, he said, well, they told me after I took your blood pressure, I should draw some blood.
Was he using a red marker, you said?
Absolutely.
Hey, Jesper.
Hey, Sam.
It's a long time no see.
Yeah.
I'll see you around.
Yes.
Hey, Pastor Aaron. I was talking with Jasper, but I didn't know what to say.
Well, Sam, have you tried wheat?
No, what's wheat?
Well, let me tell you. Wheat is an acronym, stands for W-H-E-A-T. Where do you live? What are your hobbies? For H, E is, what are you experiencing right now? E-A is acquaintances. Maybe you and Jasper have someone in common that you both know. Or T is travel. Try out wheat the next time that you meet somebody you haven't seen in a while, or maybe somebody new, and you'll have something to talk about.
I will try it next time.
And then, if you get stuck even when you're trying wheat, you can always say, tell me more.
Okay, I think I'll try that next time I see Jasper.
Jasper, can you share with us some crazy story that happened this summer?
Yeah, a couple weeks ago, I was mountain biking and I fell down on my arm and I landed on a bee's nest. And so then I broke my arm. It was very painful. It kind of hurt a lot. The craziest part was that I got stung by two bees during it. Yeah.
Wait. Tell me more.
Oh, yeah. So a couple... a couple...
A couple of weeks ago this happened?
Yeah, it did.
But it happened like a couple of days ago.
Yeah, a couple of days ago. And then...
Keep going.
And then, so after that, I had to go to the hospital. And I was there really late. And then I had to get an x-ray, and it was kind of scary.
Tell me more.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. Everybody there was super nice. And my mom was with me. Yeah, it was pretty painful, but they gave me some pain medication, so it doesn't hurt that bad anymore.
Whoa, are you okay?
I was dying.
That's so crazy. I don't know.
know white American people have a culture? I didn't know that until I was 25 and I lived in Egypt. I kind of grew up believing I didn't have a culture. I guess it felt like culture is what other groups of people have. We feel we don't have anything special. We are just normal. But for Egyptians, their normal is normal for them. And my normal is normal for me, but our normals are different. We have different cultures. Let me give you just one example of how I learned this. I was invited over to my neighbor's house to celebrate the iftar feast at the end of Ramadan, and the hostess was serving tons of yummy food, and she filled my plate. Ooh, it was so good. Now, my mom and dad had taught me to clean my plate at dinner, eat all my food. And so at this dinner, I did. I cleaned my plate. And so the hostess, seeing my empty plate, she gave me more. And I gladly accepted it, and I cleaned my plate again. Wow, that was so good, I said. I couldn't eat any more. You must eat more, she said. Is my cooking bad, or are you sick? Here, have some more. And she put more food on my plate. Now, I'm hearing my mom in my ears telling me to clean my plate. Don't waste food. And I start to work on this third plate. But I can't do it. I can't eat any more. Now, the hostess takes my nearly full plate from the table. Thank you, I say. This food is so good. Thank you. And she smiles at me, and she's satisfied. Then she brings out a dinner plate completely covered with dessert. And I think this is for the whole dinner table. But she sets it right in front of me, and then everyone else gets their own. Oh, I nearly fell off my chair. It was so full. Anyways, I survived. And I asked around about what was going on at this dinner, and I found out that in Egypt, cleaning your plate off is a signal that you are still hungry, and leaving your plate full means you are satisfied. That's polite dinner culture in Egypt. And clean your plate, that's a white American culture thing. Now, because I had thought that white culture is just actually normal, it never even came to my mind that eating dinner politely in Egypt could be a different normal, could be different. But different places and peoples have different ways of doing things, including white Americans. That's our culture. And our culture is just one in a rainbow of cultures. If we want to build healthy relationships between people of all races and ethnicities and cultures, all God's people, we have to know our culture too, so that we don't just assume, like I did, that our normal is normal everywhere. Rather, all cultures are a sacred part of God's story. God's story everywhere.
Hi, thank you for meeting me. I have so much to tell you. So, me and my family decided to go to Duluth, and It was just one disaster after another. First of all, on the car ride, my dad promised me yogurt, perfect. And then he said, we'll just get on the way back, which was fine. Then we decided to go to the beach, and it was closed, so we have to walk like 3 miles to the other one. Then there were crawfish everywhere. We had to walk all the way back in the 90 degree heat with mosquitoes everywhere. I swear, I had like 20 bug bites from it. And then to top it all off, my dad gave me no yogurt on the way home. No yogurt, can you believe it? Oh, Deuteronomy McJesus, you're the best emotional support T-Rex ever. Thank you for being there for me.
Ronnie McJesus, the emotional support T-Rex, life-size and huggable, the best listener, a good friend in every age from the Jurassic to today.
We cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. So, welcome to the Bible Buffet. How do you tell people about the kingdom of heaven? How do you talk about something that is in some ways beyond description? You tell stories. That's what Jesus does. And we call these stories parables. Parable is a Greek word which means to throw alongside. Jesus uses these kinds of stories to draw pictures that point to and come alongside the kingdom of heaven. They don't give us the full picture, but each one paints a new and intriguing piece of the portrait. The kingdom of heaven is like farming or planting grain, Jesus says. The kingdom of heaven is like wheat and weeds growing together in a field. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed and yeast and a hidden treasure and a net and a merchant selling pearls. And that's just in Matthew chapter 13. Jesus loves comparing the kingdom of heaven to things that people would have encountered in their everyday life. Now, the religious leaders and teachers were listening to Jesus' stories as well. But Jesus' parables just confound and anger most of them. Who's this Jesus guy, they're saying? Who gave him authority to talk about the kingdom of heaven? That's our job. His stories are nonsense. Now, what is Jesus' reply to them when they question him? Well, it's the same reply the prophets of God have been giving for centuries to the people who had scoffed at the word of God. They have eyes but do not see, and ears but do not hear. The leaders of our ancestors, the religious teachers and authorities, were rejecting the word of God spoken by Jesus through the parables. They had eyes but weren't seeing what Jesus was doing, and they had ears but they couldn't hear the word of God through Jesus. So what about us today? Jesus invites us to see again and listen again, just as the prophets of old did, and long, like they did, for the word of God. Some call this longing the beginner's mind, which is simply knowing that we don't know. And when you are holding your own ideas and your own values and your own words, you are deaf and blind to the mind and heart of God. Being certain that I know is a dead end, but acknowledging I don't really know anything means Jesus can finally teach you something, or rather, let you discover something. That is perhaps one reason Jesus taught in parables. Parables do not hold one simple explanation, but an ongoing, always unfolding truth, a truth that you can continue to discover your whole life long. Parables are not meant to be completely explained or moved past. Parables are meant for beholding and questioning and wondering over and savoring. Jesus meant these stories to confuse us and confound us so that we never completely understand, but always long for more understanding. And it is that longing, that beginner's mind, that keeps us from closed-eyed certainty, keeps us in open-eyed wonder, keeps us always looking and listening for God's word all around us every day. After all, that is the good news, quote, that the kingdom of heaven has come near. And as you share your sacred stories of your life, you can see and hear God here with you, near right now. Amen.
Missing church? Wish you could be back in the sanctuary? Well, now you can bring that Sunday morning feeling home with Pigpen brand Holy Dust. We've gone to empty churches and painstakingly collected and sanitized sanctuary under pew dust. Use our handy applicator, dispense it wherever and whenever you want that in-church feeling. Smell that real in-church feeling. Thanks, Pigpen brand Holy Dust, for making me feel like I'm really there. Missing church? Get your Pigpen brand Holy Dust for only 6 easy payments of $666. Remember, Pigpen brand Holy Dust. That holy feeling.
Hey, Bela, can you share a story with us?
Yeah. So a few years ago at church camp, I went with my confirmation group, and we were in the basement of the main building, and we had Pastor Aaron had split us up into little groups. And he had asked us to talk about some things. And at first I wasn't sure that I wanted to, but then once I began talking, it felt really nice that everyone was paying attention and listening to me. And I felt really like loved, and I felt that God was listening to me through them. And it just felt really nice to be able to talk to people and have them pay attention.
One love.
Today we're going to be doing a yoga pose. This pose is called the tree pose. Put one foot onto your leg and keep your hands together in front of your chest. This pose, you're supposed to stay steady, just like God keeps us steady in our lives.
Looked up and noticed he was nameless, he was homeless. She asked him his name and told him what hers was. Gave her a story, about that.
With a glint in his eye and a corner of a smile, one conversation, a simple moment, the things that change us, if we notice, when we look up, sometimes.
They said I would never make it, but I was built to break the mold. The only dream that I've been chasing is my own. So I sing a song for the hustlers trading at the bus stop, single mothers waiting on a check to come, young teachers, student doctors, sons on the front line knowing they don't get to run. This goes out to the underdog. Keep on keeping at what you love. You'll find that someday soon enough you will rise up, ooh.
Taxi back to the kitchen, talking to the driver about his wife and his children, on the run from a country where they put you in prison for being a woman and speaking your mind.
She looked in his eyes in the mirror and he smiled. One conversation, a single moment, the things that change us if we notice when we look up sometimes.
They said I would never make it, but I was built to break the mold. The only dream that I've been chasing is my own.
So I sing a song for the hustlers trading at the bus stop, single mothers waiting on a check to come, young teachers, junior doctors, sons on the front line knowing they don't get to run.
This goes out to the underdog. Keep on keeping at what you love. You'll find that someday soon enough you will rise up, yeah.
God in you when you sing so beautifully and act so nicely, so I want to give you this. Rock on.
Thank you.
Easton, do you have a prayer concern you would share with us today?
Yes, I do. God, why is coronavirus still around? I want to hang out with my friends and play with them. I haven't done it for like ever. And I also want to I want to pray about my grandma because her back is really, she has back pain, but I would love you guys pray for her.
May the Lord's light and love bless you as you leave here today listening for God's story. Amen.
Tables, breaking off chains, when I see you in the stranger,
love you.